Let's go back to the phone lines, talk to Jonathan in Omaha, Nebraska. Hi, Jonathan.
Hi, Hank. Thank you for taking my call.
Pleasure.
I kind of find your program an answer to prayer because I have a 20-minute commute every day and I get to listen to you. And I'd also like to thank you because I feel like you've helped me to draw a distinction between essential issues and secondary issues, and that's been very helpful for me.
Great.
So it really has helped a lot. I have a question. I have a coworker. He goes to a church here in Omaha, and the church is getting ready to be a part of a tri-faith distinctive or a tri-faith effort where they're going to have a Muslim mosque, a Jewish synagogue, and a Protestant church. And they were even at one point in time going to have a Greek Orthodox church to be a part of this group, but they're going to share a piece of land, and it's going to be, they're going to have a park, and each of these buildings are going to be on a different section of this land. And I know that it's wrong to say that we all have the same God, like Jewish, Muslim, Christianity. But I was wondering if it was bad for them if they kept their professions of faith while being on the same property together. And but my friend told me to come with a question because he invited me to a forum. And I'm like, well, I don't really have a question, but I wanted to hear what you thought.
Yeah, well, look, we live on the same planet. The problem, I think, is not that we cannot share with one another, commune with one another, but we have to recognize that there are very significant distinctives, as you have pointed out in the prologue to your question. A Muslim will say that a Christian is committing the unforgivable sin of shirk in saying that Jesus Christ is God. In other words, they have committed an unforgivable sin, a sin that will not be forgiven in this life or in the life to come. Pretty serious charge. A Christian, on the other hand, will say that Muhammad is a false prophet and that he is demonstrably a false prophet. Not only that, but is a very, very poor example in terms of how he treated women and how he treated the whole idea of war, his worldview, and therefore a false prophet who should never be followed. And yet the Muslim Shahada is very clear. You know, there's only one God, Allah, and Muhammad is his prophet. So they deny the Trinity, and they're following a false teacher, and a Christian would point that out. A Jew thinks that we are following a false God when we say that Jesus Christ is God as well. So in other words, at the very heart, when it comes to the essentials of the historic Christian faith, there is no way of reconciling these religions. They can all be wrong, but they can't all be right because they all have very significant distinctives. And so now you have to figure out how you can communicate with gentleness and with respect and use every opportunity to do that. But this idea that somehow or other you can homogenize Islam, Judaism, and Christianity is sheer myth. I mean, there's a book out right now. It's called The Myth of the Andalusian Paradise. And one of the great myths that's being communicated in popular culture is this idea that from the time that the Muslims conquered Spain in 711 to the time that they lost control of Spain, right around, I think it was 1462, during that whole time, Muslims and Christians and Jews lived together in perfect harmony. This is the kind of narrative that is being communicated, and it is absolutely false. I mean, if you look at the actual data of what happened during that period, sort of called the Golden Age of Islam, you will see that this was one of the most brutal and bloody ages of all time, in which Muslims were decapitating Christians and crucifying them. And instead of tolerance, the watchword was intolerance. I mean, in Islam, you have three choices. You can either convert and submit to Allah and say the Shahada, or if you're in a Muslim land, you're a dhimmi, which means that you have to pay zhizhe, which is you have to pay a poll tax, and you are considered a third-class citizen. So in actual Muslim theocracies, this whole idea would be laughed at. I mean, if you go to Saudi Arabia, for example, and I've got a good friend in Saudi Arabia who's a head of a pediatrics ward in Riyadh, he and I walked Harvard Square together, but we could never walk the Kaaba Square together because I'm not permitted there. Nor could I ever pull out a Bible in public and profess the name of Christ in public in Saudi Arabia. You know, I'd be crucified or killed or beheaded. I mean, these are serious crimes in a Muslim theocracy. So the idea that somehow or other these religions can be homogenized, they can't. But we are to treat Muslims and Jews with gentleness and with respect. We are to exhibit love, not hate. And we are to communicate our faith and do that as God gives us opportunities to do that. But the idea that somehow or other, again, that we can all sing Kumbaya and we all kind of worship the same God, and we're all part of the three great Abrahamic religions, and because somehow or other there was tolerance and three religions living in harmony in the past, we could do it in the present, is simply buying into myth and a popular narrative in our culture.